Good morning students, welcome to the English class. I am Dr. Tripti Gupta from Shiv Jyoti Education Group, Kota. Now, today we are going to take up chapter number 6, The Making of a Scientist from your book Footprint. This chapter is written by Robert W. Peterson. So, before moving towards the chapter, let us first look about some information about the author Robert W. Peterson. So, students, let us look here about Robert W. Peterson. He was an American newspaper writer who later became a freelancer author of magazine articles and books, especially on the topics of sports and scouting. He was raised in Warren, Pennsylvania. He was a writer and editor with the old New York World Telegram newspaper, which folded in 1966. Peterson's book, The Boy Scouts, An American Adventure, was written in 1984 on the eve of the 75th anniversary of Boy Scouts of America, BSA. So, these were his major achievements, few are more. And here in this chapter, he has written this story, Making of a Scientist, where he has described how a boy who grows up and becomes a very remarkable scientist from America. So, students, our chapter, The Making of a Scientist, is a story of the very renowned scientist Richard Ebright, and he has received the Searle Scholar Award and the Shearing Plough Award for Biochemistry and Molecular Biology. It was his fascination for butterflies that opened the world of science to him. So, now let us go ahead learning about how a small boy turned into a very renowned and award winning scientist. So, here at the age of 22, a former scout of the year excited the scientific world with a new theory on how cells work. Richard H. Ebright and his college roommate explained the theory in an article in the Proceedings of National Academy of Science. So, here Richard, when he was 22 years old, along with his roommate, he wrote he presented a paper, and in that paper, in that research paper, he came out with a theory about that how cells work, a theory on how cells work. And this paper he wrote along with his roommate, his roommate was there along with him in this complete work. Okay. And this paper, this article was published in a National Academy of Science. This is a very highly reputed journal of science where this article was being published. Okay. It was the first time this important scientific journal had ever published the work of college students. And since his work was so good, it was of so high significance that his work was being given space in this journal. In sports, that would be like making the big leagues at the age of 15 and hitting a home run for your first time at bat. So, this accomplishment was something like that, a small boy who is just playing for the first time, and on the very first time when he bats, he has gone for a home run. So, this was a great accomplishment for these two college students at a very young age of 22. Now, for Richard Ebright, It was the first in a long string of achievements in science and other fields, and it all started with butterflies. So this journey of achievement of Albright started when he was quite young, even when he was like a small kid of kindergarten. This journey started, and he started his journey of scientific research with the collection of butterflies. Now here, Albright was the only child of his parents. An only child, Albright grew up north of Reading, Pennsylvania. So he used to reside in Pennsylvania, and this is the place Reading, and he used to stay in the north of this place, and there wasn't much I could do there. He said, I certainly couldn't play football or baseball with a team of one, but there was one thing I could do, collect things. So as we can see, he has shared that he was been staying in a very lonely place where there were hardly any playmates, and that's why he justifies that he hardly had an opportunity to play team games. So in that case, he started he shifted his interest towards collecting things over there in his nearby area. Okay, so he did, and did he ever, beginning in kindergarten, Albright collected butterflies with the same determination that has marked all his activity. So at a very young age, when he was in kindergarten, he started collecting butterflies with a great determination, and in also along with collection of butterflies, he also involved in other activities with similar determination in his life. He also collected rocks, fossils and coins. So his collection was not only dedicated on butterflies only, he also used to collect rocks, various fossils, remains of plants and dead animals, okay, and the coins also. He became an eager astronomer too, sometime stargazing all night. So later he found stargazing to be very interesting activity, and he was very deeply involved in gazing star. He used to keep gazing stars for complete night. Now this was how the journey of Albright it started, and from the first he had a driving curiosity along with a bright mind. So he was a bright child with a very bright and intelligent boy, and he had a very longing and he was a very curious person as if a personality. If we see him, he was altogether a very curious person, and that made him to become a scientist later on. He also had a mother who encouraged his interest in learning. She took him on trips, brought him telescopes, microscopes, cameras, mounting materials and other equipments, and helped him in many other ways. So this gives us a background that his mother used to be a very encouraging parent, and she used to, though his father was no more, then too, being a single parent also, she used to equip Albright with all sorts of equipment. She used to provide her all sorts of scientific gadgets so that he can pursue his research inclination towards exploring the various aspects of scientific world and the nature. So that is how he was being encouraged towards exploring new facts of science. I was his only companion until he started schooling, his mother said. So she used to be the only friend of his until he went to school. After that, I would bring home friends for him, but at night we just did things together. Richie was my whole life after his father died when Richie was in third grade. So, at a very young age when he was in grade 3, his father died, and thereafter both mother and the son, they were the very hard-souled, they were very close companions. She and her son spent almost every evening at the dining room table. If he didn't have things to do, I found work for him. Not physical work, but learning things. So, this is how his mother has shared that how she used to come out to find some involvement for him so that he can mentally engage in some or the other explorative activities. So, if she used to, whenever she finds that there are absence of some or the other interesting activities for Ebright, she used to come out with new activities where she can make Ebright to involve and to explore the various areas of science and nature. He liked it. He wanted to learn. And see, this was not only from one side. Ebright, being a very bright student, he always learned very fast. He loved to explore new things, and he wanted to learn new things. Okay. So, and learn he did. He earned top grades in school. On everyday things, he was just like every other kid. His mother said. So, apart from this aspect of studies, he used to be a very bright student, as I was telling you, and he used to score top grades. So, he used to score all A grades in his school, and rather in other things, he was as similar like any other kids of his age. By the time he was in the second grade, Ebright had collected all 25 species of butterflies found around his hometown. So, at a very young age, he was able to collect all 25 types of species of butterflies which were being there around him, and that made him to be a, we can see here that, see here, these were the various 25 butterflies that he collected from his nearby area at a very young age when he was hardly in class 2. That probably would have been the end of my butterfly collecting. Ebright has shared that probably when he made that collection of 25 butterflies, probably maybe it was possible that he may stop collecting the butterflies further. But then my mother got me a children's book called The Travels of Monarch X. That book, which told how monarch butterflies migrate to Central America, opened the world of science to the eager young collector. So, at that very stage, when he has already done the collection of all 25 species over there, his mother, she introduced him with a book that was named as The Travels of Monarch X. Now, in this book, it was about how monarch butterflies, they used to migrate towards Central America, and this was a phenomenon which was being observed with monarch butterflies. Okay. And here, this Ebright, who was quite young, he was opened to an idea that, see, still there can be n number of species which he has up till now not collected. Now, at the end of this book, there was an open invitation from a scientist who has written this book, that is the Dr. Frederick is the author of this book, and he had given an open invitation to his readers. Okay. See here, at the end of the book, readers were invited to help study butterflies' migration. They were asked to tag butterflies for research by Dr. Frederick A. Urquhart of University of Toronto, Canada. Now, so there was an activity which was being asked by Dr. Frederick to be done by whosoever was being interested to take part in that activity. Now, what that activity was, to identify and to search out, to do the research over this migratory habit of monarch butterflies, he invited the readers that whosoever wants, they can tag the butterfly. That means there is a mark which was being placed on the butterflies. You can catch them and you can tag the butterfly wings over there, and then you can release them. So, whosoever apart from will catch that butterfly who has been tagged, they will be able to understand that from where that butterfly has migrated, how, till what distance it has flown. So, this was a type of research which was been going through, and Dr. Frederick was been taking up this research. So, this invitation was been accepted by Ebright. Okay. So, Ebright's mother wrote to Dr. Urquhart, and soon Ebright was attaching light adhesive tags to the wings of monarch. So, in this manner, Ebright, he found a new research activity. He started collecting, catching those butterflies, and then there was an adhesive tag which he used to place on the wings of those butterflies. Now, anyone who found a tagged butterfly was asked to send the tag to Dr. Urquhart. So, this was the activity. Now, the butterfly collecting season around breeding lasts 6 weeks in late summer. So, this was a breeding season where you can find butterflies to be wandering around, and in these were the 6 weeks in summer season. So, normally what was required is that you need to chase the butterfly, you need to catch them, and then you need to tag them. Okay. So, this was the activity which he has to perform. If you are going to chase them one by one, you won't catch very many. So, this was a very tedious job, catching a butterfly, chasing them, and then catching them and tagging them. So, it would be taking lots of time, and that season for chasing the butterflies was for a very small period of time. So, the next step for Ebright was to raise a flock of butterflies. So, what he did, he found another way of doing this particular work, tagging work, that what he will do, he started breeding these monarch butterflies, and that is how he would catch a female monarch, take her eggs and raise them in his basement through their life cycle, from egg to caterpillar to pupa to adult butterfly. Now, as you must be aware about the life cycle of butterflies, so Ebright used to, what he used to do, he used to catch a flock of butterflies and he used to breed those butterflies in his basement. Now, he used to observe his complete life cycle there itself in his basement, right from the eggs to build to the caterpillar stage, and then it moves to the pupa stage, and then finally it comes out to be a adult butterfly. Okay, so then what he would do, that he used to, then those adult butterflies, when they used to come out of the pupa, he used to tag those butterflies and release them. Okay, then he would tag the butterflies' wings and let them go. For several years, his basement was home to thousands of monarchs in different stages of development. So, this was an ongoing activity which Ebright, he took up for quite some years, and he took it with great determination and kept tagging the butterflies like that. But gradually this became a very monotonous, and he started losing interest in this tiring and tedious job. Okay. So eventually I began to lose interest in tagging butterflies. So this was Ebright. He has shared that how he has lost his interest. It's tedious and there's not much feedback. The reason why he lost interest was because there was not much of feedback which was coming when they were being caught anywhere, whenever the tagged butterfly. So what he found, that hardly two of the tagged, his tagged butterflies were being caught, and then too they were being found just hardly 75 miles away from his house. So there was hardly any very positive and worthwhile results out of this activity. So that's why he was losing all his interest. Okay. So in all the time I did it, he laughed. Only two butterflies I had tagged were recaptured, and they were not more than 75 miles from where I lived. So this is how the results were not very fascinating. Okay. So that made him to finally find out some other way in which he can find out his involvement in the other science activities. Then in the 7th grade, he got a hint of what real science is when he entered a county science fair. So when he was in 7th grade, he participated in a science fair, and in this science fair he lost the competition, okay, and lost. So he was not able to win that science fair. His experiment lost that competition. It was really a sad feeling to sit there and get anything while everybody else had won something. So he, that loss when he did not win in that science fair made him to have a determined that he got a determination towards identifying the new areas of science, where how he can go for some real experiments in science so that he can win some, he can go for some prize winning experiments, and he can also participate as a, and he can win in science fairs. Okay. So that motivated him. Now his entry was slides of frog tissues which he showed under a microscope. So this was his work which he presented in that science fair. He realized the winners had tried to do real experiments, not simply make a neat display. So only making a neat display of frog's tissue did not serve the purpose, and that's why he did not win, because the winners, they have come out with some real experiments which were being, which was actually missing in Ebright's work. Okay. So already the competitive spirit that drives Richard Ebright was appearing. So at that moment he started feeling highly competitive, and he was feeling sad also when he lost that competition. I knew that for the next year's fair I would have to do a real experiment. So now here he made up a mind that if he want to win in that science fair, he need to come up with a real experiment. The subject I knew most about was the insect work. I had been doing in the past several years. So as we know that he was a great collector of butterflies, and he was been tagging those butterflies also. Also he found himself to be good with lots of insect studies. Okay. So he took this area to be explored further for some real experiment. Now for that reason, so he wrote to Dr. Urquhart for ideas and back came a stack of suggestions for experiments. So Dr. Frederick, he replied him with a number of suggestions on which he could work out and he can go for some real time experiments. Those kept Ebright busy all through his high school and led to prize projects in county and international science fair. So he kept following those different suggestions which he got from Dr. Urquhart, and he when he took all those suggestions, he went ahead for some real experiments. His experiments, they won prizes in the county science fair as well as in the international science fairs also. For his 8th grade project, Ebright tried to find a cause of a viral disease that kills nearly all monarch caterpillars every few years. So this was an habitual aspect which was seen in monarch caterpillars, that they used to get infected by a viral disease. So now Ebright, he took this new study when he was in grade 8, that from what is the source of that viral infection, and this study he took up further. Now Ebright thought the disease might be carried by a beetle. This was his presumption. He had this, he assumed that beetle must be the carrier of that viral infection which is causing all the caterpillars of monarch butterfly to die because of that viral infection. Now he tried raising caterpillars in the presence of beetles. "I didn't get any real results," he said, "but I went ahead and showed that I had tried the experiment. This time I won." So now this time his experiment, when he showed that beetles in presence of beetles, he made all those caterpillars to be bred, and then while breeding, this viral infection did not happen because of the presence of beetle. Now this experiment was a real experiment, and though his theory proved to be a wrong theory, but then too his experiment being a real time experiment won the prize. Now the next year his science fair project was testing the theory that viceroy butterflies copy monarchs. Now the next year for science fair, he started with a new experiment, and this new experiment was that there are two species of butterflies. One is the monarch butterfly, another are the viceroy's butterfly. See here. Okay. So the theory was that viceroys look like monarchs because monarchs don't taste good to birds. Viceroys on the other hand do taste good to birds. Now see here, these are viceroy butterflies and these are monarch butterflies. Okay. Now what exactly the theory was which was being assumed by other scientists, that the viceroy's butterflies, they try to copy in looks with monarch butterflies, and the reason for copying, why they wanted to look alike, was because they wanted to protect themselves to become the food of birds. Okay. So because it was being assumed that monarch butterflies, they don't taste good to birds, and if viceroy butterflies, they will look altogether like monarch butterflies, the birds, they may just get confused with the viceroy's butterflies that they would be monarch and they will not eat them. Okay. So that is the theory, and Ebright, he started going ahead with this experiment, that is this theory is correct or not. Okay. So Ebright's project was to see whether in fact but birds would eat monarchs or not. Okay, so he found that a starling would not eat ordinary bird food. Now, starling is basically is a bird which has been prominently found in that area, and he found that this bird is not having a normal bird, it did not consume a normal bird food, and it is fond of basically it used to eat monarch butterflies. Okay, so it would eat all the monarchs it could get. Now, this was the food. Monarch butterflies proved to be the food for starling bird. Okay. So, Ebright said later research by other people showed that viceroys probably do copy the monarch.